All right, so a lot of you guys voted that you want more mixing tutorials. So in this video, I'm going to show you how to mix your beats. Now, specifically, we're going to mix what's called a two-track or a stereo track. In short, you're mixing one thing. You're mixing everything in one, basically. Okay, so firstly, we need to understand that when it comes to hip-hop, at least, you have two main types of mixing. You have mixing something to be super hard, or you have just trying to mix something to have clarity. Those are two different things, in my opinion. When you're mixing something to be hard, you're trying to square off the sound and create as much harmonic content as possible and really work on those impactful transients. If you're trying to make something just more clear, then we're going to focus on more of taking the mud out, taking out things that just, we need to create contrast between frequency groups. That sounds more complicated than what it is. Now, most of the mixing occurs in the sound selection itself. So when you guys tell me that you have muddy beats and muddy this and muddy that, chances are you're just using the wrong starting material. The only time something should be muddy, in my opinion, is if you have a sample and it's just embedded in that sample. Now, anything else outside of that is your job as a music producer to pick better sounds. And I mean that on every level. Sounds on a sound design level shouldn't be very muddy unless it's like a creative muddy. Okay, so I know I'm kind of generalizing, but everybody works with different starting material. Without further ado, let's mix this G-Funk track. Okay, let's go to song mode. So firstly, we need to hit Control L to send it to the mixer so that we can add effects. Now, keep in mind, this track is already mixed. So you guys are probably, you're going to be asking me how to mix stuff, but you have to remember that unless we start from absolute scratch and unless you send me your exact song, everything's going to be different all the time. There's just core principles that you need to follow. So the sounds are coming from the rolling cloud, which in the rolling xenology, so all those sounds are clean, they're pristine sounds. So there's not much to take out. There's no errors in the sound. So firstly, what we're going to do is pull up a compressor. Now, a compressor you don't always need per se. It just depends on the vibe. Actually, before we even get into the compressor, we have to ask, do we want this track to sound quote unquote hard? Meaning, should the kick and the snare go boom? If so, then we need to look at clipping first before we move into the compressor. So let's open up the clipper. I like K-Clip. And what I start to do is lower the threshold here. You can also clip mid and side information. You don't need to memorize all this stuff that I'm teaching you guys here. But if, let's say you like the clipping, but it's just clipping too much of the sound, you can pull it to the mid so it's only focused on that. This also might be a monitoring tool as well. It says adjust the mid-side stereo field ratio prior when centered. The input stereo image is left unaltered. It's pre-clipping in single band. Okay, never mind. Okay, so what we're going to do is pull down the threshold here. You can start to hear the sound crunch. You hear that crunch. Now, when you add more crunch, you're taking away what's called dynamic range, okay? So you don't need to know everything about everything I'm saying, is that the more you soft clip and the more you guys clip, the less ups and downs you'll feel in the music, which actually makes your music sound soft. So there's an in-between spot to where you're clipping just enough to add more harmonic content, but you're not overly clipping to where now everything's a flat line and you have no dynamics to even vibe off of. Your ear needs dynamics to keep it engaged. It needs stuff to change and move over time. Let's pull up the input here. And if you listen to the top of that kick, you now hear that crunch. And what we can do is just turn up the threshold until we get the maximum loudness without losing that crunch. So here it goes woof like that. Now, if I exaggerate this, it went from woo to pa, woo. Now it's going pa like that. So you have to balance that, there's a sweet spot. So the main thing is just as long as your head can bob or that you feel the beat and you're not losing all that dynamic, the biggest mistake I see a lot of mixing music producers do is they'll kill all the dynamic and they lose all the vibe of the song. It's louder, but it's just you can't vibe with it because nothing's moving, like quite literally moving. Okay, so now let's open up the compressor. There are 1,001 compressors you guys can use. There's no one magical compressor. Now, if you want to get more advanced and talk about saturation, you could talk about the Black Box. This is a good saturator. You also have the Fab Filter Saturn 2, really good. I'll show you how to use both of these. It depends on the song, but if you need that density in your bass, this is a nice start. I like to set mine to low pass mode, and we're going to low pass everything below about 100 hertz. You could do 200 hertz if you need knock in your drums, but I like to solo everything below 100 hertz. So that's going to be saturated to create what's called upper harmonics. So now the bass can be heard. Let's solo this area. So this is the signal that the saturation is affecting. If I crank it up, you'll hear the crunch. Now this is solo, so let me pull off the solo. You gotta be careful with saturation, because the more saturation you add, the more squared off the sound becomes. And in short, you know, when you take a sine wave type kick drum, which is very boomy, and then you start turning it into a square form, it just thins out, okay? It loses that boom factor. So you gotta be careful how hard you push the bass. So this is adding that density to the track. We're gonna lower the output. So let's do a before and after. Here's before. And we're really gonna hear it with this bass. Now that bass jumps out just a little bit. Okay, so that's the technique you could use to fill up your track. If you have more drums that need like that smack factor, I'd like to use Fab Filter, but most people don't tell you this. Basically, you can add modulation here, an envelope generator. So now I can drag this over top the mix level. And basically, you click here and then lower your threshold or raise it up. So I'm gonna raise it. So anytime the kick goes above this point, it will saturate the sound, and you'll get that crunch just on the kick and the snare. And it won't affect the rest of the track. That isn't that loud. So now you can hear that crunch in the kick. Now that's an extreme amount of saturation. And really, that's just taking care of these invisible things we call, not invisible, but transients that most people talk about. So let's A-B. You know, here's it before. Here's after. It's a lot more dense. Let's see the before level. Actually, to monitor this, let's use this plugin. Hopefully, I don't need iLock for this. It's been a while since I used it. We're gonna calculate the peak values just so that we gain match, so that we're not tricking our ear, even though, you know, so much to teach y'all. But here's before. Let's just read the peaks before. Okay, so the dynamic range is sitting around 16 dB of dynamic range, 15 dB, which is good. You know, a good spot is around 12. So 14 is good. And it says our peak value is negative 4.3. So now let's add these plugins and see if we are above negative 4.3. Okay, it says we're at negative 4.2. So we're pretty much the same exact level, quote unquote, dB level, but you can hear the difference. One sounds louder, one doesn't. And that's the small difference when you mix. That's what mixing is for, these subtle differences. Now the bass is a little heavy. Okay, but that's the magic of mixing, is understanding how to go from, you know, the picture before to the picture after. So we went into all these. Next is a compressor. I probably wouldn't use a compressor for this specific track. There is no right compressor. There's no wrong compressor. I'm sure there's more favorable compressors, but I don't want you guys to get caught up on a compressor type. For more organic stuff, I really like the 175 or the 176. I always mix these up. Yeah, 175 is nice on acoustic drums and more acoustic vibes. I wouldn't use this on really trappy type stuff. It adds that glue. It really is meant for more acoustic drums, in my opinion. Compressors, you're not really going to hear the compressor. It's meant to create what's called a subconscious groove. And that's simply lowering the volume and shaping the sound. You can't really hear a compressor. You're not supposed to hear it. It's just shaping a groove and pulling everything together, so to speak. There's other compressors. I don't have my iLock on me. But a really good one is the Weiss DS1 MK3. I really like that compressor. It just sounds super clear and clean and transparent. And I'm trying to think of any other compressors. I really don't use these compressors on stuff, but Pro C3 is also a go-to. And then you would raise your attack. Now, if you had to pick, you know, a compressor and kind of put it on basic settings, I think 30 milliseconds of attack and 100 milliseconds of release is a good starting point. Okay, I'm copying that from the SSL. And then usually 4-to-1 ratio. And I'll pull up the threshold. You don't need to memorize this. Every song is completely different. And as you can see, the volume just dips every time that kick hits, basically. Now, you can set the sidechain so that it doesn't listen for the kick. These are more advanced techniques. You don't need to memorize what I'm doing here. But if you would lower the threshold in that case. Now I'll exaggerate the compressor so y'all can hear. So if you want that 90s vibe, you would compress it heavily because that's how you get that dynamic moving more. But for this one, we're just trying to pull stuff together. We're not trying to make it jumpy. Now that bass is heavy, so you would go back and kind of monitor that bass. Now after this, you would go to your EQ. Let's start mixing where that bass comes in. Maybe I'll do a part one, part two, part three, because this one's taking a little bit long. That bass, in the multi-tracks itself, I would re-level the actual bass, because right now the bass is just screaming over everything else. What we can do is find the source fundamental of that bass, which is around 50 hertz, and just pull that down a little bit because the bass is doing a lot. Now, usually when I make corrective EQ moves, I'll add that before anything else. So let's add this in the front of the chain because this is a corrective thing that I'm doing. Now, I didn't start here because we didn't have that bass active at the time. We're just trying to make sure that hill doesn't get too high. There's no rules for this. We're just trying to pull down the general area so that bass doesn't overload the other processing. Now the bass still has an intense area around probably 100. So I say about 140 to 200. So this is why I said, instead of affecting everything, I would usually go back to the bass itself and pull this area down. For the meantime, we're gonna use a dynamic EQ just to tame the area. But typically I would address the bass itself so that we don't have to affect everything. And then at this point, you're gonna pull up an EQ just to add the accents that you want. So this is a really good free EQ. It sounds incredible. Now also we're gonna pull down the input because we're going in loud. If you wanna open up your track to make it feel taller, pull up the highs. Now again, that bass is extremely loud. So that's something that we would have to go back to the actual track. So let's keep boosting here. I like this EQ because you can't overdo it. It just sounds great. So that's pretty much it. And then lastly, you would add a limiter. Now, we would still have to keep going back and forth and back and forth to make small changes because that bass for this specific track. Then you would just add that last limiter. I have a limiter on mine for the video, but... And I pushed the limiter to where you could still hear the dynamic, but it doesn't make everything completely flat. So again, let's do it before and after. Here's before. Here's after. So again, that bass is a little too loud. I would have to go back to the individual sound itself to turn it down. That's how you mix. And now but for this track, you also want to think about the imaging. So Isotope Ozone Imager would be a great plugin to widen this track out, or, you know, bring a little more loudness through with. The ear can feel the sound. You don't always need to pull your bass in mono. It's just that mono means that both speakers are playing the sound out at the same time, so you get more power behind the sound. So that is how I would mix that track. Now, it is a little loud in the bass. So you, again, that bass, I would go back to the individual sound itself. So if you guys want part two, like this video. And thank you for subscribing. It's Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. Peace.